Hey, Amy.
Yeah, Juan?
Give me that beat.
It's Baseball Shangri-La with Amy Cuevas and Juan Ramirez.
And welcome to another episode of Baseball Shangri-La. She is Amy Cuevas, and I am Juan Ramirez. We got a lot to talk about on this show, but we're going to start the show the way we always start the show, with our segment called Base Running Blunders. Amy, do we have any base running blunders?
I think we caught them all in the episode. So unless you guys hear anything, let us know, and we'll make those corrections the next time around.
Okay, we reserve the right to correct that base running blunder once you guys let us know. But let's get right into it, Amy. This is a subject that I feel is not talked about a lot, and that is the gondola. If you guys don't know what we're talking about, there is a proposal that there would be a gondola that would run from Union Station and would take you right to Dodger Stadium. And there is a prototype of the what would you call it, Amy? Is it the gondola or what do you?
It's a cabin. The cabin itself. Cabin.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I am an ESL champion, so I refer to Amy so she can teach me English. So the cabin is in the left field parking lot. And so what I find interesting about this is there was supposed to be a vote on this in December, and that got postponed. There was supposed to be another vote. That vote in December got postponed to this past Wednesday. Well, nothing happened. And Amy, correct me if I'm wrong, I don't think they've announced when the next vote will take place.
No, all that they've just referred to is that next week they're going to hear the environmental impact report. So they're going to get more information on that. But they have not announced the actual vote itself, to my knowledge.
So from my experience with these situations with the votes, when a vote gets delayed like this, it's usually because they don't have the votes. They don't have the votes to pass this thing. Correct me if I'm wrong, Amy, but are you getting that same vibe?
Yeah, I mean, and especially when you see the pros and cons from both sides, you have the Frank McCourt side that is clamoring to get this project done. They've already, you know, kind of pushed it off to a couple companies that they're working with. I think it's Zero Emissions Transit and Climate Resolve, which some people have pointed out they actually don't have any experience working with aerial tram systems. So that's an interesting tidbit of news there. And then you have people who are on, like, there's Twitter, there's a page, Stop the Gondola. There are people in the community who are actively against it. So I think it comes down to where you fall on the side of this. There's many people who think that this is a great service that will get, you know, people from one place to another, cut down on traffic. The people who are against it think that, you know, it would be an eyesore. It's invasive. It's going to be in their backyards. A lot of these towers that they're going to have, some of them might be anywhere from 40 to 50 feet off the ground. There's some places that they're saying in the State Historic Park might be even 26 feet off the ground. So, I mean, it's a big change. I don't know. Where do you fall on this one?
First of all, there's no way in hell I'm getting into that gondola. I'm afraid of heights. First of all, I'm afraid of heights, but I safety is a huge concern for me. So I would much rather, you know, I take the shuttle. You know, when I go to Dodger Stadium and if I go in a non-media capacity, I take the shuttle, you know, and I'm perfectly fine continuing to do that. I think also the bigger issue, Amy, is the fact that this gondola is associated with Frank McCourt. There are billboards, especially if you go through Chinatown, there are billboards that are against the gondola, and they put Frank McCourt's name on there. And I think that's very smart. I don't know who's putting up these billboards, but I think it's very smart for them because he is involved in this project. As a lot of you already know, Frank McCourt still owns part of the parking lot there at Dodger Stadium. So he is the one involved in this project. So the fact that you associate the project with McCourt, that is already going to upset Dodger fans. It's already going to upset Angelinos. So it's going to go ahead and draw the ire. And I think it's, this is why they're having a hard time getting the votes. I think McCourt is hurting this project. And even if he tried to quietly, you know, stand in the background so he wasn't associated, people knew that he was involved in this, and they're the ones putting that out there.
Well, and from what I'm hearing in a lot of, I tried to read articles on both sides to get, you know, the full picture. They still don't have the full financial picture. It sounds like he hasn't provided that. So when it initially started, it was in the like $100 million amount. And now they're looking at, it might be like a $500 million proposal, but nobody has still seen that proposal. So to be this far along in the process is interesting when, again, you have a company that doesn't really have experience in the aerial tram system. And we also don't have the financial proposal yet. It's just, it's very interesting.
I'm shocked that there are financial shenanigans taking place when it's a Frank McCourt project. I'm glad that you filled us in on that. The other thing I think that our listeners need to know is, I think also the way they're trying to sell this is, not only is it a gondola that will help supposedly with transportation issues, because we all know the nightmare that it is to get into Dodger Stadium, to get out of Dodger Stadium, but they also want it for the Olympics, because this gondola is supposed to be ready by 2028. When the Olympics are here in Los Angeles. I think, again, I would not, if I was in that area, I would not vote for it. I would not participate in the gondola. But Amy, I don't know if you were going to bring this up anyways, but for me, it does trigger just memories once again because of that neighborhood. Not only, you know, Chavez Ravine, but going through Chinatown, it just, I mean, I don't know when's the last time you've been through that area, but there's a lot of housing projects that have been put in Chinatown where I just sit there and go, who can afford to live here? Like, what are we doing here?
Once again, it just feels like underserved communities are kind of getting the shaft in this respect. Like, a lot of the people who are against it are those people who live there. And to your point, like I would never ride it. I tend to go in by myself just because I drive in because I'm usually by myself. And for safety reasons, I feel safer going by myself, finding a parking spot and knowing where I can get in and get out. A lot of people are pointing to what you mentioned, the Dodger Stadium Express. They're saying, you know, we already have a clean energy alternative. They're natural gas buses, but we could be focusing all the money we'd be throwing into this transit system that not everybody would potentially even be riding, to focusing on replacing those buses with even an electric option, or having more areas where people can go and hop on. So not just the two areas that they have right now, but expanding the pickup locations. And that would better serve the communities, because a lot of the people are focused on, hey, what have you done, you know, to actually help our housing situation, to help our public transit in general? Like, this is more of a, like, I can't think of the word, but not like a glory project, but like, this doesn't benefit the neighborhood itself. It, as they're doing the construction, they're actually going to be even more inconvenienced having all of those construction cars, the additional parking once it is actually in place, with people parking all over Chinatown to get to these locations. Like, I think that we could put our resources somewhere else that would better serve the community and would also better serve the people who are trying to get into the stadium. And to your point, some of the comments that were made, I was looking at Stop the Gondola on Twitter or X, and a couple of the comments that people put up were kind of referencing what you just spoke about. So one of them said that the public comment started off strong. When we want progress, we tend to encroach on those who are least fortunate. And the last Metro Vanity project near Chinatown displaced thousands in Chavez Ravine. And somebody else posted that when developers see green space, they just see dollar signs. First, they came for the Mexicans and Chicanos. Now they come for the Chinese. This is Chavez Ravine 2.0. So the community definitely feels a certain way about this, Frank McCourt involved or not. And I think we need to listen to the people in the community, too. That just, again, my opinion. These are my opinions only. So putting that out there, too.
No, and look, I appreciate you bringing that all up because I do. I mean, Chavez Ravine is just something that, I mean, we're going on, what, 70 years, you know, and there are still, I mean, was it last year when there were protesters that ran on the field at Dodger Stadium, or was it the year before?
It's like every year we get at least one where they're, you know, remember Bishop La Loma and Palo Verde. Like, it happens regularly.
Yeah, and I think you asked the right questions right there, though, Amy, is like, how is this a benefit to the community? And I know that, again, it's low-hanging fruit to sit there and go, anything that's associated with McCourt, I don't want any part of with it. I mean, the man already used the Dodgers as his own personal ATM, and I'm sorry. You know, I know years ago when that happened, he was sitting there going, I want the Dodger fans to give me a chance. You haven't earned it. You haven't earned it because you were not honest. And in this same situation right now, it sounds like he's not being honest when you're not telling us how much this is going to cost. And I'm curious, are any public funds going to be used for this? Because it just... It does.
Well, and that's the question, because initially when it started, it was going to be all private funds and sponsorships were supposed to carry this. So some of the articles I was reading was pointing to that. But now since LA Metro has taken over, there are a lot of concerns around, okay, now that this is more of a public project, once you get the initial, you know, production done, who's going to handle the maintenance and the upkeep as it goes on? Sponsorships only go so far. So does that then get passed on not only to the taxpayer, but again, impacting those communities there as well?
Yeah, it's just funny because in the Dodger circles that I run in, I don't hear many people talk about this topic. And this is something that we're going to continue to monitor because, again, we wanted to talk about it on this show because there was supposed to be a vote that was going to take place on Wednesday. And of course, the vote got postponed. And it's like, look, this dog doesn't hunt. And we're going to continue to monitor it. But I think what Amy said is the most important thing is, how is this a benefit to those communities? We already are suffering with a housing problem in Los Angeles. And if this project is going to result in more displacement or create more situations where people can't afford housing, that's a no for me.
Same. And being that I go to 40 to 50 games a year, I will never write it. You brought up safety. That's not something that I would look at as safe. So even let's say somehow it did get passed, I will not be one of the people writing it.
Oh, hell no. That's not the way I want to die. I really don't want to just peril to my own death. I want to segue to, speaking of underserved communities, this has been a big week. I want to start first with the Oakland A's. Yes, those poor Oakland A's who just have been going through it. You know, it's not bad enough that the Oakland is losing their baseball team. And now you're hearing stories, whether it's conflicted narrative, that the Vegas deal is not a done deal, even though Manfred is coming out there and saying, no, there's nothing wrong. There's nothing to see here. Vegas is fine. But the Oakland A's actually did something that I am very proud of, and that is they announced the first female play-by-play announcer. Amy, fill us in on the rest of the details.
Yeah, so she's the first in MLB history. So she will be doing live game coverage. She's a 20-year media veteran. She has 17 years experience covering baseball, and like she will be covering a majority of the A's games. Like, I think this is amazing for the sport.
What's her name again, Amy?
Sorry, it's Jenny Cavnar. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, and she's worked with the Rockies. She's worked with the Padres. She has a lot of experience. She mentioned that she grew up, her dad was a baseball coach, so she came by baseball naturally. But she had some quotes, and I'll have to look them up. Maybe I'll post them up on Twitter or X. But she just mentioning that, like, when she first started out, she wanted to be a reporter on the sidelines because that's what she saw. It never occurred to her to be like a play-by-play announcer or broadcaster because women weren't in that role. And then when she kind of a happy accident happened, she realized this was something that she wanted to do. But again, it goes back to representation mattering and seeing people in those roles to be able to know, oh, hey, that's something that I might be able to do, because we just don't see women in those capacities.
And I hate to say, look, like I said, I'm very happy to say this, but I hate to defer to you because you're the woman on the show, but I don't want to say that your voice is more important on this, but I am more interested, and I think you've hinted on it, like what it does to see someone like that break through the glass wall, so to speak. Like, what does it do for you?
It's amazing. When I saw this announced, like even a couple years ago, I think she did one of the first games with the Rockies. And when I saw that, it was a big thing on the internet. It was just like, I think you mentioned it in our first episode. You grew up listening to Vin Scully, Jaime Jarrín. We women, we girls growing up, who do we have? Like, we have a better idea now. Even women on the sidelines they have a more prominent place. But even in my, like, I think late teens, early 20s, when they were there, it was more just, okay, we gave them a role. And now I think it's women getting to show, like, hey, I know this sport, I can do this job. And unfortunately, it takes women longer to get there. We saw that with, I think it was Kim Ng with the, was it with Miami, where, yeah, with you know, it took her 20 years to do what, you know, a man would have done in much less time. And then once she did have that role and she flourished, they hired somebody over her and she ended up walking away from the position. And it's bittersweet because we're celebrating this amazing milestone, but we're in 2024 and it's like, wow, this is the first woman play-by-play, like the primary one in MLB history. Like, it took us this long. And so I'm excited. And I'm also a little sad that, like, it's still taking us this long, but you know what, we'll go with the excitement and the fact that we're trending in the right direction. And hopefully she's going to inspire many more girls growing up to not only watch baseball, but realize what they can actually accomplish.
Yeah. I'm happy about it because for me, having a diversity, is just, you bring voices, new voices. And I think hearing new voices is always a good thing. I think it keeps things fresh. So in a week where the Oakland A's did this, here in LA, Allie Clifton was the first woman to be a color analyst on a Lakers broadcast. And you could sit there and say, well, she only did it, Juan, because Stu Lance was sick. And it's like, look, for whatever reasons why it happened. The Lakers could have gone something else. They could have gotten a dude to do it, you know, but she was given the opportunity and she did it well. I mean, look, this industry, we're seeing it more. I am a big fan of Joy Taylor. Joy Taylor on FS1. I think what is so fantastic is these women are so good at their jobs, right? That you just sit there and you go, man, why did it take so long? Like Amy said, for them to have an opportunity to do that. So, look, we're seeing it more and more in baseball. We see women on coaching staffs. I would love for it to continue so it doesn't become something so special that it is part of it. Like, look, I feel there are so many female Dodger fans that are just as knowledgeable, even more so. And I love hearing them because they have the perspective that maybe they are looking at it in a way that I never thought of looking at it. So I think it's fantastic that we're getting more of an opportunity to hear these voices.
I think it's really important that not only that we get to hear them, but we get to see it happening. There was another kind of milestone. I hope I don't butcher her name. Her name is Jen Pawol. She's the first woman to umpire in MLB spring training since the last woman did it in 2007. And I was reading up on it. Whenever the MLB needs a fill-in for additional umpires during the regular season, they draw from a group of AAA umpires that are named to the MLB call-up list. And those are made up exclusively from umps that have been invited to the MLB spring training. So she has the opportunity to potentially umpire in an MLB or like a Major League Baseball game, you know, if it happens. But there's that, again, that pool to draw from of women umpires even is so small. I was just reading up, I think I mentioned her to you before. There's a woman that I follow on social media. They just interviewed her on one of the Sabre podcasts called, Sabrecast by Rob Nair. And her name is Melissa Ludke. She's the one in 1977 who sued the MLB to ensure that she had equal access to athletes for women sports reporters. She is the reason that I am able to go into the clubhouse and interview players. I can go in the dugout and interview Doc. Like these women, she did this in 1977. And where are we now? 2024, where we're just now getting our first female play-by-play in Major League Baseball. So these women paved the way, but we need to shorten that gap from these milestones to the next time a woman gets raised up.
And it's overdue. I mean, the NBA has female referees. I think even the NFL does. So to have a female umpire, look, it's overdue. These are qualified people. So I'm so glad to, because it feels like to me, and I could be wrong, that I feel like baseball is just probably, maybe all sports are conservative, but it feels like baseball is even the most conservative, which is crazy because we're talking about the sport that had Jackie Robinson, right? Jackie Robinson came from Major League Baseball. But yet I feel like, especially when it comes into these issues of diversity and equality, that baseball just is behind everything. And look, when Amy and I talked about doing this show, we never had this conversation, I think, Amy, but like it was important to me. And that was to have a female voice. There are a lot of Dodger podcasts and there's a lot of they're male dominated. Right. And that is just not my experience. When I go to Dodger games, I see a lot of women at Dodger games. And they are very passionate about baseball. So I always scratch my head and be like, well, why is it not translating into the new media world? And so that's why for me, I didn't have to hesitate when Amy's like, let's do a show together. It's like, it's perfect. You know, I like hanging out with Amy, but it also checks off the box that we have a female voice on this show. And yeah, whatever. She has a poor taste in movies, but you know, I can live with that. You know, she embraces bad movies more than I do, but I can
live
with
forever. It. Jaws 3 forever. I think that's what it is though. Like that, I will die on this hill along with, you know, when we get into the season, small ball, like that is my thing, but representation matters. Seeing somebody out there who looks like you, sounds like you, or at least is just adjacent, because right, we still have a long way to go. There aren't really that many podcasts out there that I can follow that have people like me. And that's not just in sports. Like there's many places in this world. So we can either keep waiting or we as women step up, move. I know for me, there was a lot of doubt, at least like, is this something I can do? Am I going to get called out? Like I had my own stuff to deal with, but at the end of the day, I love talking about baseball. I love hanging out with you. I love our conversations. And it's like, well, why not? What's stopping me other than me? So I hope we can grow that trend so that, you know, little girls, little boys, whoever, this becomes the norm. And it's not such a, oh my gosh, wow, this is the first one in history. It's no. Look at this amazing qualified person that got this awesome job.
Absolutely. Speaking of that, the Ohtani hype, it has now been, we're close to a week of, you know, Ohtani showing up to spring training. Amy, how has the Ohtani experience been for you? I know you're worried about the show bays, but you know, I want to hear, like, looking, being able to see all of this, is this what you expected or is this even like a little much for you?
I mean, it's what I expected. Like that, like he comes with all of this glory that goes with it. I am surprised at a lot of the negativity around it. Like at least I'm hearing, you know, gosh, like spring training, it's so cluttered. Like there's so many more fans that like the media, it's changing everything. And it's like, well, what did you think was going to happen when we got him? But also going back to that topic, representation matters. You know, Latinos had that when Fernando came in. He was able to reverse all of that bad trauma around Chavez Ravine and bring Latinos, Chicanos, Mexicans, whatever you identify as, back to the stadium. Well, Shohei is able to do that for Asian cultures. They have somebody that they can look up to that's like them, that they can identify with. And I just think any of that negativity, like, let people have their moment, like let them have somebody that they look up to, whether you're Asian or not, you can just respect him as a player. But this is what comes with him because of the caliber that he is.
It is interesting to me that just like the fact that him taking batting practice and the number of people, the number of times that video was shared. I know we've talked about it in past episodes, and it just seems like it's just like, leave the guy alone. Just go ahead. I mean, is this going to continue throughout this? I mean, can it continue throughout the season to have this? I mean, the amount of energy that he sucks up, it does seem a bit much, at least to me.
Well, you covered him at Angel Stadium last year. Like, what is the difference between last year to now, other than the change in uniform?
You know, it was much shocking. It was much more shocking to me because it was the first time I experienced it. But after we went to Dodgers Fest and being able to see it on spring training, I get it now. It's just one of those things. But at the same time, I can't deny the fact that I feel like this is good for baseball. Like, to have a hunger, to have an appetite, to want to know about something before Shohei, I can't think of any player in Major League Baseball. And I get it that Shohei is a unicorn, right? But I can't think of any player like this that demanded. I mean, we are talking about something like, I imagine that this is what, like, if you see the documentaries of the Dream Team, like when they were following Michael Jordan around, like, this is, I haven't seen anything like that. I wasn't around for Fernando Mania. And I know some of the people that I've talked to who have been around for Fernando Mania, they say that Fernando Mania was bigger than Ohtani. Because now that is something that I think is interesting, in the sense that the Ohtani fervor is more media driven, and it seemed like Fernando Mania was more fan driven.
Yeah, but if you are recording these events to be able, like Fernando Mania, like the fans were here. You have a lot of Shohei's fans that are still in Japan, other countries in Asia. So not everyone can make it here. So it's their responsibility to be able to grab that footage and that content to relay that back. So the people who can't be here in person have access to it. I mean, I was alive during Fernando Mania, but I was like 1 year old. So it, other than, you know, carrying his baseball card around and he looked like my father, so I would tell everybody that was my dad. Like, I mean, that's the extent of my Fernando Mania experience. But I just, we're also witnessing history. So, you know, for better or for worse, this is what's going to probably continue. It would have happened with our team, or if he had signed with another team, it was going to happen. I think LA, because of the community and the diversity, it gives it a different lens for that to filter through. But at the end of the day, we're still in whatever capacity, in a media capacity, as a fan, we're still witnessing history.
Well, what I found was interesting was today I saw all this coverage. He literally just stood in the batter's box as Emmett Sheehan was basically throwing a bullpen. And I'm just like, how is this a story? Like, it was Emmett Sheehan throwing a bullpen, but somehow it became, there was a necessity to report that Shohei stood in the batter's box as Emmett Sheehan was throwing this bullpen. Now, I think the important things to know newsworthy about Ohtani, because we do lose sight of the fact that he is still coming back from an injury. And there was a belief that, you know, he might not be ready by opening day. But now it seems from all reports, he either has been healing very, very quickly, that he might be ready for Korea. Now, my concern is this. Is Ohtani going to force himself to play in that series because it's the Korea series when maybe he's not fully healthy? Like, is there pressure being applied? Maybe not necessarily by the Dodgers, but maybe is he applying pressure to, because he knows his stance. Like, there, the people, like, I was at that Dodger Stadium last year, and there was a guy who worked for Korean Daily, and he would go basically wherever the Angels were playing, and he was covering Ohtani. And even though he wrote for a Korean publication, there was so much interest in Ohtani, even though Ohtani to them is like their rival. It's the main competitor to them. So I wonder if Ohtani feels this pressure that I need to be ready. I need to play in that series in Korea.
If we're looking at it from the fact that if he's just standing inside of the batting cage and he's garnering all of that attention, couldn't you potentially, I have the same concern that we don't want him to come back too soon if he's injured, but if he does push himself, isn't the potential there for like, okay, maybe he hits the first time around in the batting order and then they pull him? Because if he's going to garner that attention just standing in a batting cage, if you at least give him one at bat and then pull him out of that game, you're at least still giving the fans something without potentially injuring him. Or do you think do you think he's such a competitor that he wouldn't want to come out after one at bat?
Yeah, and I don't think he would. And I think the one thing that we can't lose sight of, I can see that happening in the practice games that they're going to have when they play the Korean teams over there. But when they play the show pods, those games count. Those two games count. And I think that's what's so weird about this whole thing, right? Is they're going to go play two games in Korea that count, and then they're going to come back and they're going to play spring training games. So I think both things are true. I think you're going to have Shohei, who's not going to want to come out of those games, at least the ones against the show pods. And then the other thing is those games count. There, the competitive aspect, I think, comes out there. But
with how intentional they've said he is about his practice, if he, like, I'm arguing both sides, but essentially, like, if he is so intentional, he's like, he does not waste a movement. Even Andrew Friedman has said this. Couldn't you potentially argue that he would pull himself out even after an at bat, then, you know, to preserve himself, knowing what's at stake? Or, like I said, I know I'm arguing both sides here. I'm playing devil's advocate, but
I mean, if he's not feeling well, if he's not feeling right, and I think it's his responsibility to tell the trainers, they'd be like, hey, I don't know about this.
Right. Cause we saw that all last year with Tony Gonsolin pitching her and Kershaw. And again, we don't know whose role that was in that capacity. Did the pitchers not let the staff know? Did the staff know? Did they make a joint decision? But, you know, I would hope, this is my eternal optimism, I would hope that if he did push himself, that it would be in a limited capacity and he would have the wherewithal to pull himself. If that happens, we don't know.
I mean, the fact that it's going to be in Korea, I think, is the only variable, right? Because if this was a regular season game at Dodger Stadium, if he wasn't ready, I don't think there'd be a question of him playing. But, you know, this going back to like what Kobe Bryant always used to say, like the reason why he wanted to play every game was because he knew that there were kids who were, you know, saved up all their money, or sometimes they could only afford to go one to one game. This is the only time they were going to see Kobe. I'm just curious, like everything we hear about Shohei from Dave Roberts, from his teammates, is what a great person. Like I saw Freddie Freeman today, just saying like how much like Shohei cares about his teammates and stuff like that. I just wonder if that crosses his mind, that he feels this sense of responsibility to play in that Korea series to to appease the, all the Korean fans, or who knows how many Japanese fans are going to like travel there to see him play. And look, I don't hold it against him. You know, I think it's great that he has that mentality if that's what he wants to do, but we don't know, right? We're just creating this narrative.
We have like what, 4 or 5 different potential outcomes, and who knows, watch, it's going to come out of left field and it's not even any of those.
So. well, yeah, but I think it's like what you said. I think we're so used to seeing Latinos there at Dodger Stadium. And I think what's been great these last couple of years when they, I know some people aren't crazy about the heritage nights that the Dodgers have. But it was, I was there on Guatemalan night last year, and I was
there with you.
Yeah. Remember how happy they were? Like
my friend's family was there with like 20 people from their family all bought tickets and went that night. Like, you were in the melee of that.
Yeah, they were so happy to see it when they played the Guatemalan national anthem. And I wonder, like I said, we always see a lot of Latinos, in particular Mexicans, at Dodger Stadium. I wonder, with Ohtani and Yamamoto there, are we going to see more of the Asian community in the stands? Which is great, because we saw it with Nomo, you know, when Nomo was with the Dodgers on those particular nights that he pitched. So I think this is all great, because baseball is the winner here. Shohei brings just a level of attention the same way. And I know I'm probably going to alienate all these people. What Taylor Swift has done for girls who like football now, all of a sudden, that maybe Shohei is going to bring fans to who normally weren't baseball fans, and they're just curious about Shohei. So they want to see what this is all about. I mean, I still think this is underplayed. I mean, what this guy is doing, only Babe Ruth has done before. Like,
which is actually, Freddie Freeman actually had a quote about that yesterday. he said, we notice it, talking about Shohei, but I think it's more of a good thing. That means good things happen this offseason for the Dodgers. We get the guy we're going to be talking about. Our great-grandchildren are going to be talking about, just like we talked about Babe Ruth, since we're going to be talking about Shohei. So you've got the positive outlook from Freddie. And I think all of it can be true, right? Like, I know the Heritage Nights that you mentioned get a lot of flack, like, oh, it's just a money grab. Sure, yeah. They are making money. But when you see people who are tearing up because their national anthem is being played in the stadium and because they are being represented, yeah, the two are true. It's not mutually exclusive. Somebody's making money, but these people are happy to feel like they matter, to feel like they are seen in that stadium as a fan, because as you mentioned, baseball has traditionally been a predominantly white male sport. And now we are opening it up to tons of new people. We have been through the years, but even through the Heritage Nights, money grabs or not, that is still putting eyes on people and getting people into the stadium who might not otherwise have watched baseball.
Yeah, I mean, the same thing happened the year before on Salvadorian night. You know, they were so happy to be able to get Dodger gear that had some semblance of a reference to Salvadorian heritage. I think that's all good stuff. And again, I mean, it's all, like you said, it's capitalism. It's just get the people to show up. But I think that's the important thing. Like, if you get people to show up, and then they ended up realizing, hey, I actually like this, I want to keep going on.
What is that movie called? If you build it. Oh, what is it?
If you build it, he will come. So it's interesting. I'm very excited. And I think being able now to see it on a daily basis, I think I will be able to truly understand Shohei's impact on Major League Baseball and just the excitement. And I know it's going to be a little different too, because the Dodgers are the Avengers, right? So whenever they go on the road, it's not that they're just there to see Shohei, but they want to see Mookie, they want to see Freddie Freeman, they're going to want to see Yamamoto. So it's going to be interesting. So I guess you could say maybe there's a lot of hype to it, but I think eventually this is all just going to become normal to us, right? And it's no longer going to phase us.
Well, it's going to be whatever it's going to be. We're going to go to games and, you know, they're going to play. We're going to hopefully have fun. And I think you are going to, if I remember correctly, you're going to appreciate the game more and bitch less. So,
wow. Amy's totally trying to hold me to this. Look, I'm trying to be as positive as I can. At least give me until the first week of the season. I mean, when it happens, then we'll see. But I am trying to be a more human person as a result of you, but I'm not making any promises. The only thing I can tell you, Amy, is that I'm going to try my best.
Hey, that's all I can ask.
So before we wrap things up, any last words, Amy?
No, I think I'm excited for the positive changes, women in baseball, representation mattering, and hopefully the community wins out on some of the other stuff we talked about.
Absolutely. So again, if you are just coming across us on YouTube, subscribe to the channel. That way you can receive the alerts whenever we drop new episodes. Sometimes we drop them in bunches, people. Amy and I just get, and we go, you know what? We got time. We got a lot to talk about, and we just end up dropping a lot of episodes. For those of you listening on the audio portion, make sure you follow us on social media. You can follow us on X at BB Shangri LA, on Instagram, Threads, and Twitch at Baseball Shangri LA. She is Amy Cuevas. I am Juan Ramirez. You have been listening, watching Baseball Shangri LA. Amy, say goodbye to the people.
Goodbye.
Bye, everybody.